reading. All three of these are first reading, and it's found in your bulletin. Doc and Francis came from Mount of Blessing Church here in Amarillo to the SDA Church here in Amarillo. And our third one here, these are coming in. We also have Cherie Frakes from the Texaco Conference Church to the Amarillo SDA Church. And we have two that's going out, our dear friends of this church, Marcus and Gwendolyn Baker, from Amarillo SDA Church to the Adventist Fellowship Church in Tulsa, Oklahoma. They will be dearly missed. May God bless and be with them. And we just thank those who are joining us. If you are here, will you please stand, those who are coming in, so that we can get to know you? If you are here, please stand so that we can recognize you. And maybe they haven't made it, but God's blessing be with them as they join this church, and we are glad to have them. At this time, we have a few announcements that needs to be made.
Good morning.
Morning.
First of all, I have an important announcement about tonight. Everybody remember what happens tonight?
Game night.
Game night, yeah. Come at 7:15. We'll have a quick devotional, and then we will have game night tonight. It's a church social, so everybody turn out for that. It'll be a lot of fun. The other thing is, you remember we have a blanket project that's going on, and I have my lovely assistant here to demonstrate. This is an example of the blankets that we're making for the people in the nursing home. Something for them to snuggle up and keep warm. Also, Loretta, back in the back, has also been making some of these capes for the ladies. So if you would like to be part of this project, you can. There's several ways that you can be involved. You can simply buy some material and turn it over to the people who are making them. You can join the people that are making them, hemming up the sides. Or if you're like me and you're afraid you'll sew your finger to it, you can donate money, put your money in a tithe envelope and just mark it the blanket project or something like that, and they'll be able to buy the material to make these items for people in the nursing home. And let's keep that in mind. Thank you.
Let them know who Loretta is.
Oh, yeah, Loretta, I'm going to put you on the spot. Would you please stand or wave your hand? Yeah, she's sneaking it. She's back there in the corner. You got to watch her. She's... Thank you for that, too. We appreciate it.
On game night,
if you have a favorite snack that you would like to bring, bring it. Share it with everybody.
What about the rock?
Yes, we will be. We'll be. That's part of the game night. We'll be painting rocks. Yes, we will be painting rocks tonight. So. Come and see what that's all about. And bring games.
Now, Mark, do we have a deadline for the blanket project? Okay.
We'll probably be giving them out in the fall. That way it gives us enough time to make a good amount of
money. Okay. Because I do want to get involved with this, because I know there's a lot of people in the nursing home who would love to have a blanket, you know. So if you can, also get involved with them, you know. And if you can't make it, we go out and buy one, whatever it takes. Let's get the project done. At this time, we will continue with our mission spotlight.
Joshua is 11 years old and lives in Croatia, a country in Eastern Europe. From the time he was a baby, Joshua's parents took him to Sabbath school. And long before he went to school, Joshua was already playing the violin. For as long as he can remember, he's had two great loves, God and his violin. When Joshua was 8 years old, he went to Vacation Bible School, or VBS, for the first time. He loved every aspect of it, especially when he could play his violin. The next year, Joshua invited friends from the Village Primary School and from his music school. "You must come, it's great," he told them. Joshua also talked with them about God, but they didn't seem to care too much about that. They still came to VBS and liked it. The following year, Joshua's friends wanted to come again. And this time, one girl, after listening to the children's sermon at VBS, told Joshua, "This is a miracle. There really is a God." Joshua told her that God is near to her and all of us. The girl asked him for a Bible and soon received one. Now she and her mom are going to Pathfinders, and her mother also goes to a women's group at the church. One day when Joshua was 11, he heard his parents talking about a boy who was very sick. The boy had a brain tumor, and his family couldn't afford to pay for the operation that he needed. "I know what we can do," Joshua said. "We can have a concert to help raise money to help this boy." "Okay," his mom said, but she was wondering how she could possibly organize it. That wasn't a problem, however, because Joshua organized everything himself. He told his friends at the music school about his idea, and soon 15 young musicians were eager to help by playing the concert. Joshua also talked with an Adventist pastor who was willing to present short devotionals between each of the 15 musical pieces. Soon, posters advertising the special benefit concert were seen all over the village of Marushevac and at schools in the area, inviting people to come to this special program. The concert was held at the Seventh-day Adventist Church on the campus of the Adventist Secondary School in Marushevac. About 300 people came to the concert, and most had never been in an Adventist church. Joshua and his friends were delighted when they learned that their concert raised 8,600 Croatian kunas. That's more money than an average person in Croatia makes in a whole month. Even though Joshua and his friends didn't personally know the sick boy, they were happy that they were able to help him and his family. Joshua is happy to use his love for God and violin to share God's love with as many people as he can. Now Joshua is planning more concerts to help other children in need. Who knew that a boy and his violin could make such an impact? Imagine what you could do to help people around you.
home. That baby that was supposed to cry didn't cry until they got home. And then it started crying. And they said, it's a fine time to cry now. We wanted you to cry before we went. But, you know, isn't it funny how things happen? Do you think Jesus knew which baby was which? Sure, Jesus knew, didn't he? Why? Wasn't hard for him. He knew already who it was. But sometimes we do things like that, don't we? We're supposed to do a job, and we kind of forget. Mom says, go get your lessons, and you kind of forget. Well, forgetting about the twins was a little different because they looked alike. But you don't look like your brother and sister sometimes, and sometimes you look kind of like them. And you're not as tall sometimes, or you may be a little shorter than a brother or sister. So remember, you have to pray about a lot of things. And praying helps us, doesn't it? Yes, it does. It makes us good. Well, the girls began to grow, and they got a little bit taller, and they were 2 years old, could get into everything. But still, they kept the fingernail polish. They were made sure toes and fingers were always polished with that fingernail polish. And one day the pastor said, why do you put fingernail polish on your babies? And they said, because we can't tell them apart. We only know if we look at the fingernail polish who's who. And as they grew and got older, it was really hard in school to know who was who. And the teacher had to learn the fingernail polish color, because even though they were grown, they looked so much alike that it was hard to tell them apart. You think it would have been fun to be a triplet? I don't think so, because somebody would call you a name that wasn't your name, and it was kind of strange. But they grew up, they got married, and they had twins. Each one of them had twins, and it was real strange that they had twins. But it's fun to think back of how people live and how you have to keep things apart. Does mother have trouble keeping you apart? No. Does Jesus have trouble keeping you apart? No. He knows who everybody is. Even these big people out here, he knows who they are. He knows what they do. He keeps an eye on them too. So remember, always pray about things that you have problems with. And remember, Jesus sees everything you do. Okay, you can go back and find your seats.
In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 6, verse 38, God encourages his people to give. Not just coming to church to give, but to give in the community. It's just not giving your time, but your money as well. The skills that God has blessed you with, whatever it might be, you can give to help others. There was a man once, his name was Mark. He lived in Wisconsin, and he had an old car. It wasn't in the best condition, but he was driving it one day, and it was during the winter time. And you know, sometimes cars can act up on the road when the ice is on the ground. So he was driving, he came up to this traffic light, and he stopped on red. But when the light turned green, he decided to take off. And of course, he was supposed to anyway. But his car didn't want to go forward. Even when he put his foot on the accelerator, it didn't excel, you know. Something was wrong with this vehicle. And it started drifting to the right. And he stopped, and he just was having all kind of problems with this vehicle. Can you imagine the cars behind him? They was frustrated. They said, why don't this man hurry up and get out of the way? You know, he's holding up the traffic. Cars started blowing and everything. I've been in this situation one time. I remember when I had a car. I was on Western Street over by the shopping center, and my car stopped on me right in the traffic. I could just hear the horns blowing. Sound like people just saying, hurry up and get out of the way. We got business to take care of. We need to get to where we are going. Well, that's how this man felt too. by listening to these horns, people blowing up cars and the horns and everything. He felt like he was just in the way. And so finally somebody got out of their car. It was two gentlemen who got out of their car, and they start pushing him to help him push his car out of the traffic. And he thanked them for it. He was very grateful that somebody took the time to help him get his car out of the traffic. So he got it fixed and everything. Everything went fine. But there was another day as he was on his way home. It was still in the winter time. He noticed that it was another elderly man that was stuck. And he couldn't get out. So he came up behind this guy and he got out of his car and he helped push him out so that he wouldn't be stuck. And when the man started driving down the road, he didn't stop his car because he probably, you know, would have gotten stuck again. So he just waved up his hand and he said, "Thank you." And the guy that marked, who was helping push him out of his, from being stuck, you know, where he was at, he remembered that somebody one day helped him and how grateful he were that somebody stopped to help him. So he stopped to help this man. You know, we all can be grateful for what others have done for us, and we can be grateful for what the Lord has done for us as well. So as you give your offering today, give a generous offering and be thankful for what the Lord has done for you. The Lord has done so much for each one of us. If you had to just name your blessing, it probably would outweigh your sorrows. Stop and think. The Lord has really blessed each one of us, and he has blessed me. And I want to give to the Lord back to what he has given me. So with the deaconesses, please stand. Most gracious, kind Heavenly Father, as we prepare our hearts to give, may we not give grudgingly or in vain, but that we will give according to what you have blessed us. May you bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. It's now time for our prayer request. I invite you to bring your request down and place it in my Bible. The Bible tells us in 1 John chapter 5, and this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he heareth us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we desire of him. I invite you to bring your prayer request down and place it in my Bible. And come down, and even if you don't have a prayer request, whether it be written or whether you just need someone to pray for you, I invite you to come down. The Lord is willing to hear our prayers. And he will answer our prayers according to his will. So I invite you to come down now. This is prayer time. Now we serve a great God, a powerful God, a God that is willing and able to do what we can't do for ourselves. Just want us to trust him. This time I invite you to kneel with me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Our most gracious, kind, and loving Father, we come to your throne, Father, on bending knees. We give you our request. And Father, according to your will, according to your words, you promise to hear us. And Father in heaven, we just lay our burdens before your throne of mercy, because we know that you are able and willing to answer our prayers. Father in heaven, we just pray that your will be done in our lives. But many of us are struggling, whether it be finance, marital problems, sickness, whatever the circumstances might be, nothing is beyond your healing power. So Father in heaven, we just pray that you will heal us and see us through our most difficult times. Father, we all stand in a need of prayer. And we thank you, Father, for the opportunity that we can come and bring our requests before your throne of mercy, whether it be written or unspoken. You are God that answers prayer. So, Father, we leave our burdens before your throne of mercy, knowing that you will bless us, that you will keep us in your loving care. Father, we pray for the sick of this church. You know who they are. Father in heaven, we just pray for the leaders of this church as we continue to lead out, that your will be done in our lives and bless us. We pray for the speaker of the hour as he break the bread of life, that your spirit will take control and be with them. Now bless us and keep us. And we thank you, Father, for your holy Sabbath day. And for those who are worshiping you around the world, let your blessing be with them. For this we pray in the loving name of our Lord and Savior, in Jesus' name, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our scripture reading is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 52, 1 through 2. Awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion, put on thy beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. For henceforth there shall no more come into thee the uncircumcised and the unclean. Shake thyself from the dust. Arise and sit down, O Jerusalem. Loose thyself from the bands of thy neck, O captive daughters of Zion. May we all be blessed from God's word.
Where's Morgan when you need jokes? Not liking it? Okay. Sorry. I don't know what to say. I'm not the one that improvises or whatever. That's Morgan. This is why I don't like coming up here without her.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
Divided attention to our speaker of the hour, Stan Swingle. Hear ye, Stan, come forward to bring God's word.
Thank you, Booker. I feel that I have been blessed this morning already.
Amen.
Here is Veronica with that beautiful, beautiful song. And then our children. They got my heart palpitating. I was worried on that one song they'd go one level higher, and I don't know if I could keep up with it. And a real blessing. And certainly a blessing to be here with you to study God's Word. And before we do that, let's have a word of prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for the privilege of being here to share your word, to study it. Father, we ask that you will be with each one here. Open our ears, open our hearts. Help us to hear what you have for us. Help me, give me the thoughts that need to be expressed. And bless us, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
It was AD 34. It was Tuesday, approximately 2 days before Jesus would go on that faithful walk to Calvary as the Lamb of God who would pay the wages for our sins. Jesus had spent the day in the temple courts denouncing the scribes and the Pharisees for who they were and what they taught. For he was verbally attacked by group after group of the religious leaders throughout that day. After he had completed his mission there, he left Jerusalem, taking the disciples with him, and went down the western slope of the side there, the mountain, went across the Kidron Valley and ascended back up to the Mount of Olives. And there they found a comfortable resting place and sat down. And in doing so, Jesus began to share with him the future of Jerusalem and the signs of the time regarding this earth and its people just before he would return. And after doing so, he paused and then began to express his concern about his church, the church that would reside just before he would return to take his people home. He was concerned that they would not be preparing for him. He was concerned that they would not be ready for his return. And as he always did, he put his thoughts in the form of a parable. Turn with me, if you would please, to Matthew chapter 25, and you and I will examine that parable. Matthew 25, 1 through 13. It goes like this. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. 10 virgins or maidens, each possessing a lamp filled with oil. Now, what does that mean? Scripture tells us that their lamps represents the believer themselves. You see, you and I are the vessels for the oil. We must constantly be filled with this oil from day to day. We must never run out. The oil is the Holy Spirit who fills the believer with Christ's righteousness that provides illumination. Illumination into ourselves as to who we are and who we need to be, and illumination for the world in regards to the love of Christ. You see, you and I are the light of the world, are we not?
Yes.
Amen. And each maiden is a mirror of that experience that hopefully everyone here took part in when they accepted Christ. I can remember when I was 15. Prior to that time, I was in another denomination, but I came to love and to learn about Jesus Christ through the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Amen.
And I came to him, and I found out what a sinner I was, how sinful I was. I confessed that sin, and he forgave me. He brought me to true repentance. And that's when I had my true walk with him. And hopefully that was the same experience that each one here had. And hopefully your experience was as good, if not better, than mine. And these 10 virgins, these maidens, all had the same experience. You see, they represent you and I. They represent God's church. And they had their beginnings in this relationship with the Holy Spirit who brought them to know Jesus Christ. And then it says, they then went forth to meet the bridegroom. They then began their daily walk with Jesus, being ever vigilant and watchful, for they wanted to be ready when the bridegroom, Jesus, would return. They didn't want to miss him. I didn't want to miss him either. And I'm wondering if that wasn't your experience then. Introduced to Jesus, what a lovely person he is, and there's that promise of his returning, and you want to do all that you can to be ready for him. You don't want to disappoint him. And then in verse 2 it says, and five of them were wise and five of them were foolish. Now if we have this correct, and these virgins represent all those who profess to love and are loyal to and have a relationship with Jesus Christ, then these 10 virgins represent you and I. But it says here that five of them were wise and five of them were foolish, which infers to me is that in this congregation, there's the possibility that some of us are wise and some of us are foolish. Gives us something to think about, doesn't it? Apparently, not everyone who claims to be a Christian shares the same relationship with Christ. Some were wise and some were foolish. The question is, where do you and I fit in? In verse 3, it states that they were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. They took their lamps. They themselves, being the lamp, went off, began their relationship with the Holy Spirit, who was their oil. But after that, they didn't have enough oil to keep it going. The question to be asked here is, why were some of these church members foolish? As I thought about it, this is what came to mind. They were deficient, poverty-stricken, dead broke. They had no oil, completely without the Holy Spirit. They initially experienced that new birth in Christ that we just got through talking about, maintaining for a time their relationship with Him and the presence of the Holy Spirit in their lives, keeping them ever ready for Christ's return. You see, that took place for a while. You remember the parable about the sower goes out to sow the seeds, and some fell on stony ground, and some fell on in the weeds, and some fell on the ground that was quite fertile. Each seed represents a church member who had a different experience with the Holy Spirit. And they currently profess Christ, but haven't the oil to carry them through character-developing crises. You know, one of the tools that Christ uses is to allow things to come into our life that we don't necessarily like. A crisis, if you please. And it's there to teach us complete dependence, complete trust in Jesus Christ. But you see, the five foolish virgins never learned that. The foolish church members never acquired that skill, that level of faith and trust. You see, they're familiar with the theory of truth, but the gospel has affected no change in their lives. Let me read something here in 2 Timothy, if you please. I got to go back to what I call the T's of the New Testament. The Timothys and the Thessalonians and the Titus, you know that. 2 Timothy 3:5. Let me go back to 1. This also know that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce-breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures, more than lovers of God. Whew. And then he says, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from then turn away. And you say, Stan, whew, that world must be a terrible place just before he comes. And I would agree with you, it will be, and it is. But see, here's the problem. These verses aren't talking about anyone in the world. No. These verses are talking about church members. Amen. People within the church who somehow lost their experience with the Holy Spirit. You see, these people, the foolish virgins, their character does not resemble that of the other five virgins. You see, there is two groups in the church. Groups who are actively involved with the Holy Spirit. They're growing every day. They're relying on Jesus. But then there are the foolish virgins, who, much like the hypocrites of old, the Pharisees of old, they've lost that relationship with the Spirit. They don't have that growing experience. They are attracted to the gospel, but selfishness keeps the truth from taking deep root in their lives and bearing fruit of a Christ-like nature. Gives us something to think about. Verse 4, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. Why were these church members wise? Well, let's take a look. One, they took oil with them on their daily walk with Christ. They were never without the Holy Spirit because they stayed connected right? As the branch and the vine must stay connected if the branch is to receive the power, the genetic ability to reproduce the fruit that the branch once did. The wise maintained an active and cooperative relationship with the Holy Spirit, who was the source of their power to overcome temptation, and remained obedient to Christ's will for their lives. You know, I was reading in Revelation 2, we won't go through it because of time, but it's chapter 2, verses 7, 11, 17, and 26. And in every one of those verses, it talks about the fact that we have to be overcomers. And if we're overcomers, we'll inherit eternal life. We will not experience the second death. We will be given a new name that only we will know. And then in the last verse, it says, in addition to that, we must be obedient. And this is the same description of the 144,000. The expectation of the Holy Spirit is that upon our willingness to cooperate, He will transform our lives. Above all, these wise church members took a vessel that was filled with extra oil as they actively journeyed on to meet the bridegroom. So besides the oil they started out with, that they were infused with via the Holy Spirit, they took an extra vessel that was filled with the Holy Spirit. Now how did they accomplish that? You see, the Holy Spirit was not a superficial part of their lives. He was not a one day out of seven type thing. I'll pick him up on the Sabbath and leave him off somewhere during the week, and I'll pick him up again later on. He was an integral part of every aspect of their daily experience. There was not a part of their lives that God did not inhabit, that God did not control. That's wonderful. I'm still working toward that experience. They were, and this is how they got that extra oil, they were active students of the Word, applying it in a practical way to their lives. You see, it's not enough to read the Word and acquire information, knowledge. What's even more important is, what do I do with that? As I study Christ's character, I learn what He's like, and I can practice being like Him. I apply that information in a practical way to my experience. And day by day, as I make those decisions, the Holy Spirit is working His will in me, and I'm becoming more and more like Jesus. They memorized Christ's many promises, which were their shields and sources of strength. Let me see if I can't flip over here to 2 Timothy 1:4. If you haven't memorized this or read it in a while, you need to. 2 Timothy 1:4 is a beautiful promise. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine natures, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. You see, they memorized the Word and they applied it to their life, because the Word represented Jesus Christ. It was Jesus Christ. It was great and precious promises because God stood behind His Word. And there was power in the Word. You know the song, there's power in the blood? There is power to change us. And what does it change us into? It says, into the very nature of Jesus Christ. And away from the old man that was in love with the world, were enabled through the Holy Spirit to receive the power to be applied to the decisions and the desires that we make for Jesus Christ. The wise had a powerful prayer life which kept them connected to Christ. We can't say enough of that. Wish we had more time, but it's that prayer life that keeps us connected to the power that's available to us. You see, are we a Daniel? Daniel prayed publicly 3 times. Doesn't tell us how many times privately he prayed, but I'm sure he followed that admonition that we're to pray constantly. We're always to be in prayer. We're always to be in connection with Jesus Christ. He should not be a block away. He should be right here all the time, guiding us. And then finally, these wise virgins, these wise church members, being illuminated by the Holy Spirit, they indeed became the light of the world, as the Holy Spirit was able to change them through their cooperation with Him. They then were to exhibit in an exact way Christ's love for the world through them. Verse 5, it says, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. Question is, why the bridegroom tarry? Because he wanted everyone to attend the marriage. He didn't want anybody to be lost. It is Christ's desire that everyone here this morning spend eternity with Him. But He's only taking the wise disciple with Him. You see, the fellow at the door, that's the card checker, before you can enter to the wedding, says, do you have the card? And if you don't have the card, you don't get in. And that card, if you please, is the righteousness of Jesus. If you don't have His character, you and I will not enter in to the pearly gates and spend eternity with Christ. They all slumbered and slept. They all did this. The whole church was involved in this. While waiting for the bridegroom, Christ, to return, they became careless and forgot what their purpose was. Character building, service to others, sharing the gospel of love to the world. It was not building bigger barn houses to put everything that I acquire in it. It was not to become wealthy and famous. It was to die to self. Reflect a Christ-like character. Share with the world what the Holy Spirit has given to us. While the wise kept their lamps burning, it was not enough to keep them vigilant and watchful. They fell asleep. When you get home this afternoon, I'd encourage you to go to Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 to 21, and you'll find the solution to this problem here. If I may suggest, the foolish church members, on the other hand, became comatose. That state of being where I cannot interact with my environment. I don't know what's going on. I don't know how serious the condition is that I am in. They were comatose. They could not bring themselves out of their sleep, because they were enjoying life so much. They became overwhelmed by the cares and concerns of this world and became entangled in its pleasures. You know, Christ in one of the Gospels says that there are two people that who will not enter in the kingdom of God. You know who they are? One are those, that group that is anxious, overly concerned, always worried. Never had they learned to trust Jesus. When something came into their life, they didn't take it to Jesus first. They worried about it, tried to resolve it themselves. Never realized that they could completely trust the all-powerful God, our Creator. He has a solution to every problem long before we realize it's a problem.
Amen.
And here's a group that cheated themselves out of happiness, out of peace, because they didn't trust Jesus to handle their lives. And then those that were entangled in pleasure represent those people who are so engrossed in the world and what the world has to offer that this involvement has become so great it has put up a wall, if you please. It's cut the relationship in two between that church member and their Lord, the Holy Spirit. And as a result, they've created a new God for themselves. That God, whatever it is, has become more important than the God that they're supposed to serve, and they claim to serve. They became, as time went on, uncertain of Christ's return, becoming hearers of the word and not doers. So involved in themselves that they forgot the purpose that they were here for. They failed to see the seriousness of their condition. Verse 6, and at midnight there was a cry made, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him." When those of us who least look for Christ, he will return. When those who are least ready, the bridegroom will come. When great spiritual darkness covers the earth, Christ will return. I belong to a newsletter that weekly informs me of what's going on in the world in regards to spiritual concerns. And as a result, I'm to some degree able to keep up on what the Pope does and the political affairs of the European Union and various things going on. And you know, as I listen, I don't read the paper anymore, as I read the internet and listen to the news on the radio, as I watch politics do its dirty and ugly things, as I watch the degradation of man's thinking and how man throughout the world is turning his back on religion, all of this reflects the truth in that statement that as in the days of Noah, as in the days of Noah were so, shall also the coming of the Son of Man. You see what happened in the days of Noah? They made fun of poor old Noah for all those years, and finally all the animals were directed in the ark, and the door was left open for a week before it finally closed. Now let me ask you, when did their people's probation, who failed to enter with the family of eight, when did their probation close? Gotcha. No. Their probation failed way back here. You see, every time we make a decision that's not in our best interest as far as our relationship with Jesus, we start to make a habit. And the stronger and the more often we make those kinds of decisions, the stronger the habit gets, and pretty soon I produce a character.
Yeah.
That's not the character that Jesus wants. And then it's too late. I have sealed my fate back here, even though the door shut over here. They were foolish. Verse 7, then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. They all came out of their sleep. Something awoke them, and they trimmed their lamps. All the virgins arose. Think on this. They all expected to be allowed to attend the wedding because they were God's people. By the way, a couple of statements here. Spirit of prophecy says that we are not unlike the Jews of old. You know what the Jews of old believed? They believed that because they were God's favored people, automatically that provided them an entrance into heaven. We are not unlike the Jews of old. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I attend that church down on 403 Southwestern. I go every Sabbath. You ask me if I'm going to heaven? You bet. It's what they believed. Every Sabbath-keeping, tithe-paying, church-attending member expected to spend eternity with Christ in heaven. They assumed that they were covered by Christ's righteousness. They assumed. And then they trimmed, it says, their lamps. This trimming is a time that represents a time of search and inquiry that each of us, as it was exhibited in the time of atonement and judgment of old, it's a time when we inquire about ourselves. Am I who I'm supposed to be? Has there been a transformation in my life? Do I keep my focus on Jesus? Is he the most important thing in my life? These are questions that we need to constantly be asking ourselves. This trimming infers that the wise virgins listened to and followed the admonition of the Holy Spirit in preparation for and being ready for Christ's return. On the other hand, the foolish virgins have been content with a superficial work. I'm expected to attend church, therefore I will. I'm expected to pay tithe, therefore I will, etc., etc. They do not know God. They have not studied his character. They have not held communion with him. Therefore, they do not know how to trust, how to look, and to live. You remember Moses of old leading the people through the desert, and there was a stretch there, a geographical part there, where they were attacked by what? Poisonous snakes. And God directs Moses to do what? Produce a staff. Weld a snake on it. Hold it up. And anyone that looks at that snake will be healed and free from any further bites. You and I, dear family, have been bitten by the snake of sin and selfishness. And we need a healer. Amen. And the only time, the only way that we can maintain that healing, for it has to be maintained, it's not a one-time thing, is that I keep my focus on the snake. That snake that went to Calvary, who claimed my sins. Yeah. He is my healer. But my focus must be on Him every day. I cannot ever think that I'm powerful enough to do anything to help myself. For I'm not. I owe everything to Jesus. Verse 8 and 9. And the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps have gone out. But the wise answered, saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. Right out of the book of Revelation. Here's a group that realized that Christ's coming, his return, was finally around the corner. It's near. And they turned to their fellow church members and says, give me what you got. I want some of that. I want the Holy Spirit. Give me your character. Let me share something I always enjoyed, and then I later saw the seriousness of it. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6 through 11. Remember the story about the ants? What's it say? Proverbs chapter 6, starting with verse 6, going through 11. And if I go over, you'll forgive me. If you need to be somewhere, you have my permission to go. But I think your salvation is more important than us being late for dinner. Yeah. Go to the ant, thou sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise, which having no guide, overseer, or ruler, provideth her meat in the summer and gathereth her food in the harvest. How long wilt thou sleep, O sluggard? When wilt thou rise out of thy sleep? Yet a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall thy poverty come as the one that travaileth, and thy want as an armed man. Here's a story about a bunch of ants. God filled them with wisdom, where they spent spring and all of summer and as far into fall as they could, gathering all those seeds and all that grass, took it down and stored it in their homes. Those ants represent the wise church members who spent their life in becoming all that they could become through the power of the Holy Spirit, who could, through the power of the Holy Spirit, exemplify Jesus Christ in their life to the world, who spent their life in service to others, all because they found how much Jesus loved them and they wanted to respond in kind. And yet the foolish fail to do these things, fail to adhere to the admonition of those wise ants, and they found at the end they lost everything. Go to the ant, thou sluggard, and learn her ways. Not so, the wise church member said, lest there be not enough for you and us. The foolish wanted the wise version to give them a portion of their Christ-like character to satisfy the bridegroom's requirement upon entry to the wedding. This was impossible. One cannot share one's character with another. It is produced in cooperation with the Holy Spirit. That is the only way we can acquire it. Turn with me over to Ezekiel chapter 14. There's a very, very interesting couple of verses over there. It goes like this. Ezekiel 14, 13 and 14. It says, Son of man, when the land sinneth against me by transgressing grievously, then will I stretch out my hand upon it, and will break the staff of the bread thereof, and will send famine upon it, and will cut off man and beast from it. For every sin, there's a consequence. Things got so bad, though, it says, though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it in the land, they should deliver but their own souls by their righteousness, saith the Lord God. Each one of us have to walk alone in that valley of transformation. We may choose God to walk with us, but no one can help us. No one can give us a piece of their character. It has to be developed only in relationship to the Holy Spirit. Verse 10, and while they went to buy, the foolish virgins, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Again, the door was shut, but long before then, they foolish virgins didn't realize that the die was already cast against them. And while they went out to buy, the bridegroom came. This time is referring to the time when everyone who claims to be the follower of Christ will be judged. As Seventh-day Adventists, we believe in a judgment that first takes place in heaven, where Christ reviews the cases of everyone who ever claimed or claims to be a follower of Christ, starting with the dead first and going on to the living. We believe that. The problem here is, when does my name come up? The time for building a Christ-like character will come to an end at the time of my death, or when my name comes up in the judgment. When either event happens, there is nothing more that could be done. So when I die, my probation is at an end. What I've done here or haven't done will be applied to me. I don't get a second chance, as some teach today. On the other hand, if my name comes up while I'm living, maybe it came up yesterday, I don't know, then God has to look at me and examine me and say, determine, does my character that I had the potential and the opportunity to develop, does it reflect Christ's character? And if it does, he stamps my name with his blood forever, ridding me, excuse me, of any past sins, and inviting me into the marriage feast. You see, it's at the judgment that I marry Christ, if in fact I meet the credentialing process. The foolish church members weren't aware that their time had elapsed. The bridegroom, Christ, returned, and they were not ready. Only those that were daily ready to meet the bridegroom, Jesus, were approved for the wedding. You see, it's not how far we've developed, and the goal is to become Christ-like, but it's the fact that we are daily working through the Holy Spirit on becoming more and more like Jesus. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us. But he answered and said, verily I say unto you, I know you not. Their exclusion to the wedding was the result of their own deliberate choice after choice after choice. We are reminded of the parable in Matthew 25, 31 to 46. You remember the parable of the sheep and the goats? What did Christ say, you know, he, to make it short, he says to the goats, he says, well, you know, eternal damnation to you because, you know, you haven't done the, your behavior does not replicate that of the sheep. And he went on to give the sheep eternal life because of their behavior. And the goats step back and say, oh, they get a little worried, sweat on their brow, you know. Whoa, we have done the very same things as the sheep. That's the Pharisees, see, talking. Done the very same thing. What did Christ say? Those terrible four words that no Christian should ever have to hear. I never knew you. I never knew you. And he didn't know them, not because the behavior was different, because it was essentially the same, but the motive behind the behavior. You see, the goats weren't wearing the robe of righteousness, the character of Christ. But the sheep were. They had acquired it. Everything that they did was motivated by love and concern for someone else. There was no I in their life. But the funny thing about it is they didn't realize that they were being transformed. The closer they came to Jesus, the more they realized how unfit they were. And the more like Mary, they kneel at the feet of Jesus and wept. Oh Lord, I need help. And we're given a promise that anyone who comes to Jesus in need, he will not cast out. Performance was not the issue here. It was all about character. Finally, verse 13, it says, watch therefore, for ye know not neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. Let me share this final thought with you. In Desire of Ages, page 633, it says, Christians are not to await their Lord's return in idle expectancy. While waiting and watching, they are to be vigilant in purifying their own souls by obedience to the truth, and to be earnest in working for others. It is their privilege not only to look for, but to hasten the coming of the day of the Lord. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for being so very patient with us. Father, we dearly want a closer relationship with you through the Holy Spirit. We need your insight, for we are so blind. We want you to come into our lives. Help us to be willing to give up everything. Of our own power, we can't. But you promise us to deliver us from our sinful nature, to provide us that power. And Father, we ask now that you will come into each and every heart. Make us new and help us from this day hence to maintain this relationship with you through the Holy Spirit, so that one day we will be ready and we will welcome the sight of you. For we ask it in the name of Jesus and thank you. Amen.
Thank you.
We bow our heads. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Amen.